The conflict in this begins with the five Iroquois nations who formed a great league in the 14 to 1500s. With the five nations no longer infighting, they turned their focus on the Susquehannock, who held territory south of theirs. As a result, the Susquehannock settlements shifted to the south, to the extent that by 1610, they were at the lower Susquehanna River near modern-day Harrisburg, where they soon became enemies with the Piscataways and other northern Chesapeake natives. This shift meant the newfound colonies of Maryland and Virginia were forced to pick a side to be safe within the political sphere of the Native Americans. Virginia allied with the Susquehannocks and Maryland with the Piscataways. Now, in the 1620s, Virginia Secretary of State William Claiborne had a successful trading outpost on Kent Island, and when it was revealed that it would be annexed into Maryland, he and the Susquehannock protested, since Maryland's Lord Proprietor was a Catholic. For the English, Catholicism represented tyrannical rule and their enemy, the French. For the Susquehannock, their enemies, the five Iroquois nations, harbored Jesuit missionaries, and may have been wary of Maryland colonists since they too harbored Jesuit missionaries. Due to this, the Susquehannock attacked Marylanders, the Piscataways, and other natives that allied themselves with Maryland against the Susquehannock throughout the 1630s until the 1650s. William Claiborne, during the English Civil War, was given a commission to take Virginia and Maryland to parliamentary authority. Upon his March 1652 arrival, his navy made quick work of the colony of Maryland. With Maryland now under his control, he made a treaty with the Susquehannock, which by extension also functioned as a treaty between the Susquehannock and the Piscataways. Despite the Calvert family regaining Maryland in 1657, the treaty with the Susquehannock was kept. This newfound safety to their south enabled the Susquehannock to engage with the Iroquois Confederacy to the north. During this time, they cultivated alliances and procured arms from Maryland's government. Despite early victories, the war ate away at them, as by the early 1670s, they only had 300 warriors. Despite the 1652 treaty, Maryland officials never fully trusted the Susquehannock. Even so, after their defeat, they invited the entire nation to move to Maryland. This move of the Susquehannock to the Piscataway River only raised tensions between the Susquehannock and both the Maryland colonists and the Potomac Native tribes. In the summer of 1675, a herdsman named Robert Henn was killed by Doeg Native Americans in retaliation over a previous fight because of a debt that the Doeg were owed by Robert Henn's master, a Virginian planter. The next day, Virginia militiamen seeking reprisal killed 14 Susquehannock people, not realizing the Doeg murderers were in a different cabin a few hundred yards away. This gave the Susquehannock a dilemma, as they needed to respond to the murder of their people, yet their alliances with Maryland and Virginia were important, as they did not want to lose their newfound home on the Potomac Valley. Because of these factors, they restrained themselves to killing two Virginians, promptly followed by an offer of peace made to Virginia, stating that they were content to renew and confirm the ancient League of Amity with Virginia. However, times had changed, and while the Susquehannock needed the alliance with Virginia, the colonists did not need the Susquehannock and saw no gain from continuing their alliance. Despite Governor Berkeley's hesitance towards conflict and the Susquehannock's optimism, Virginia chose war. By September 1675, 1,000 armed colonists amassed from Maryland and Virginia towards the Susquehannock fort on Piscataway Creek, aided by neighboring natives who saw this as just another battle against the Susquehannock. Despite the Susquehannock losing five or six of their native leaders on the first day of the siege, by the sixth week of the siege, more colonists than Susquehannock were killed. The entire Susquehannock community was able to escape, with most heading to a refuge near the Virginia-North Carolina border. From there, they struck against Virginian plantations, forcing them into palisaded compounds and more populated parts of the colony. Now the Susquehannock attacked from James River's Falls up to Maryland, which only invited speculation about other tribes collaborating with the Susquehannock. As a response to these retaliatory attacks, frontiersmen asked Governor Berkeley to grant Nathaniel Bacon a commission to lead a militia against the natives, which the governor refused to grant. Ignoring such a refusal, Nathaniel Bacon raised a militia of 500 men and headed to the Susquehannock hideout on the Roanoke River in the spring of 1676. From this was born Bacon's Rebellion. Governor Berkeley reacted publicly to Bacon's act, revoking his position on the Virginia Council and outlawing him. What is often described as a Virginian civil war made little difference to the Susquehannock. In the end, they were still Virginian colonists attacking the Susquehannock. The neighboring tribes did distinguish between the Baconites and Berkeley's men, as the Baconites didn't just want to wipe out the Susquehannock, but they wanted to rid Virginia of all Native Americans. During this time, the Susquehannock inhabited two forts, the smaller of which had 30 warriors, alongside some Manakin and Aniletan warriors who were pressured into joining them. After moving to the Roanoke River, the Susquehannock tried to seek allies, one of them being the Okanichi. But their overtures failed, as the Okanichi preferred to ally themselves with the Virginians whom they traded with. The chief of the Okanichi tribe, Posseclay, met with Bacon and disclosed these facts. While Bacon was eager to attack, Posseclay told him to stay and rest his men, and that he would take the fort for him. Collaborating with the Manakin and Aniletan warriors within the fort, they attacked several days later and killed many of the 150 inhabitants of the fort. The Okanichi returned to the Virginians, bringing a small mountain of beaver pelts that they kept in their fort as plunder. Unfortunately for the Okanichi, Bacon pestered them for a share of the pelts, despite not participating in the battle. This arguing persisted until shots broke out at midnight, and by the next afternoon, over 100 Okanichis were killed. Even more surprising is that upon returning to Virginia, Bacon described the destruction of the Okanichi town as a greater victory from a sharper conflict than ever yet has been known in these parts of the world. While Bacon was absent, killing natives, Berkeley called another election in early June 1676. Nathaniel Bacon was elected into the House of Burgesses, representing Henrico County, a testament to Bacon's popularity. On June 6, Bacon went to Jamestown to attend the June Provincial Assembly, when he was arrested. Bacon was brought in chains to Jamestown, where on his knees before the assembly, he asked for a pardon. Berkeley said, "God forgive you, I forgive you." Berkeley even restored Bacon's position on the Virginia Council. However, upon hearing rumors of another arrest, Bacon fled Jamestown on June 11th. This is where Bacon's war against the natives became, in a sense, a Virginian civil war. Bacon was popular, and his support wasn't just over the military commission, but over other grievances the colonists had with Governor Berkeley, like taxation and policies that favored the wealthy. For example, this Isle of Wight County document states their grievances when they write, "Whereas there are some great persons both in honor, rich in estate, and have several ways of gains and profit, are exempted from paying levies, and the poorest inhabitant being compelled to pay the great taxes which we are burdened with, having a hogshed or two of tobacco to pay for rent, and near 200 yearly for levies. Having a wife and two of, or three children to maintain, whether our taxes are not the greater by such favor and privileges granted them, which we desire to be safe of, by their paying of levies as well as we, they having no necessity from being so exempted." This was alongside the fact that in 1670, the General Assembly made it so only men with taxable property could take part in governing Virginia, as it was thought it made them more invested in the public good. Bacon arrived with over 500 men at Jamestown and forced Berkeley to grant him military commissions. He also issued the Baconites a general pardon. Now, with a military commission, Bacon did what he set out from the beginning to do, attack the natives. which is why he left Berkeley in Jamestown after securing the military commission. Since the Susquehannock and the Oconeechee were beyond his reach, he set his sights on the Pamunkey and other tribes within Virginia. Since the Pamunkey were allies of Governor Berkeley, he took many as prisoners, while spending 2 weeks pursuing them in the Great Dragon Swamp. They and the other native allies to Virginia helped keep Bacon distracted, wasting time campaigning in the Virginia swamps. In July, once again, Berkeley declared Bacon and his supporters rebels, and Berkeley fled to Arlington Plantation on the eastern shore, where he had stronger support. After his campaign against the Pamunkeys, Bacon returned to his base near Jamestown, telling his men to return home. This was when Berkeley took the opportunity to retake Jamestown without a single shot. Hastily gathering his men in September, Bacon besieged the capital for 11 days. Berkeley's loyalists escaped via the sea, and his ships were forced into the James River, allowing the Baconites to take the capital once more. But fearing loyalist reinforcement from the north, they set fire to Jamestown on September 19th, knowing they wouldn't be able to hold the capital. After dealing with the loyalists, Bacon once again set out to fight against the natives, where he would die from dysentery in October while on campaign. Unlike Virginia, Maryland stayed true to the Piscataway allies, both defending them from the Baconites and assisting their attacks on their enemies, the Susquehannock. Despite Piscataway eagerness, both Maryland and Virginia wanted peace. With Bacon dead in October, by January 18th of the next year, the last of the Baconite rebels disbanded, with British troops and royal commissioners arriving by the end of the month. Governor Berkeley was recalled to England. However, he died in July in England before being able to meet with the king. The 1677 Treaty of Middle Plantation stipulated that the Pamunkey and other natives within Virginia had to accept King Charles II as their sovereign and to fight alongside Virginia against outside natives. Following the Albany Treaty of 1677, the Susquehannock became dependents of the Iroquois Confederacy and returned to the north. Following the events of Bacon's Rebellion, enslavement of Native Americans increased as indentured servitude of white people declined. Bacon's Rebellion had broad consequences across the North American colonies. It greatly reduced the autonomy and influence of Native American nations on the coast and those bordering the colonies. Prior to the rebellion, the majority of laborers in Virginia were indentured servants, but in its wake, it led to the widespread of slavery as an institution in the colony, especially African slavery, which helped unite both poor and wealthy white colonists.